In 1928, a 27-year-old Walt Disney and his closest friend, Ub Iwerks, locked themselves in an office in their studio in Hollywood, hastily trying to come up with a new star for their animated shorts. Following the loss of his previous character, a rabbit named Oswald, to Universal Pictures, he was determined not to face his team of animators without something new to present them. Out of this extremely stressful moment, a cartoon mouse with round ears and red shorts was born. A mouse called Mickey. Walt Disney is not usually many people's first thought when it comes to famous innovators. Nevertheless, he was and still is just as important to the history of technology than other famous innovators, such as Jobs, Dyson, or Nikola Tesla. But how exactly did Walt Disney innovate the entertainment world? And are his strong values of innovation still alive in the modern day?
Pass me by one summer day, flash those big brown eyes my way, knew I wanted you forevermore.
A farm boy from Missouri and fourth of five children, Walter Elias Disney certainly came from humble beginnings. Walt was very fond of his hometown of Maclean, with it serving as inspiration for Main Street USA in Disneyland. However, it is especially important as it gave young Walt his encouragement for his burgeoning interest in drawing. Even when his family were forced to relocate to Chicago in 1910, his passion for art still remained throughout his high school years, drawing constantly, even if he was somewhat inattentive. At 16, he joined the Red Cross Ambulance Corps by forging his birth certificate to meet the age requirement and was sent to France in late 1918. He served in the First World War, making deliveries and chauffeuring important officers, and during this time he developed his love for drawing more, creating war-related cartoons which were printed on Red Cross posters and even submitted to Life magazine. However, the real story of the Walt Disney Company as we know it today began in 1923, when Walt and his brother Roy bought a small office in Los Angeles.
When Phil Rison was here for the RKO convention, he visited our studios, and at the time he expressed the wish that all of you could see how these pictures were made. So we have hurriedly thrown together a little film that we hope will give you some idea of the methods involved and the great amount of work involved in the production of these pictures.
Here, Disney's destiny was carved through their animated Alice comedies and other famous classic cartoons.
And as their popularity grew, so did their studios, building the new Walt Disney Studios lot in Burbank, where Disney still operates to this day.
During the 14 years that followed, Disney would create some of their most iconic characters, such as Mickey Mouse, Donald, and Goofy. Walt Disney has led an extremely innovative career. From every corner of the entertainment industry, Walt constantly pushed to reinvent how entertainment is made for both adults and children. In the Hollywood world, Walt helped with the revolution of synchronized sound in animated cartoons with his short Steamboat Willie, one of the first sound cartoons and the debut of a certain famous mouse. Walt would continue to use this technology in further animated shorts, notably his Silly Symphonies and 1942's Fantasia. This led to a new technology invented by Disney, Fantasound.
Mr. Stokowski. Mr. Stokowski! Just wanted to offer my congratulations, sir.
Congratulations to you, Mickey.
Aw, gee, thanks. Well, I gotta run now. So long!
When Disney Studios partnered with British conductor Leopold Stokowski to create the film-concert hybrid known as Fantasia, it quickly became clear that advancement in sound recording technology would be required to accurately reproduce the classical symphonies Walt had in mind. 38 microphones were used to record the soundtrack over the course of around 18 months. It would have to be played through 10 different Fantasound speaker setups, each placed strategically around the room, making Fantasia the first film commercially presented in stereo sound. However, sound wasn't the only place Disney was innovating the film industry, and in 1937, Walt Disney developed a new type of camera, specifically for the creation of depth in cartoons, coining it the multiplane camera. This new type of camera allowed Disney to transform flat one-dimensional animation into layered shots with depth and movement. It was used in many classic Disney pictures, like Pinocchio, Fantasia, Bambi, and Peter Pan.
The trouble was, we were photographing a flat two-dimensional background. So we set about making plans and blueprints for a new cartoon camera that would overcome this. The different elements in the scene were separated according to their varying distances from the viewer. This put the moon on a plane farthest away from the camera. With our original picture broken down in this manner, it is possible to control the relative speed with which each individual part of it moves to or away from the camera. But the moon remains absolutely still, and so it will always remain the same, neither growing nor shrinking in size. Of course, our cartoon camera does not shoot sideways, but is placed above and shoots downward toward the drawing. Since this new camera used many planes, we called it the multiplane camera.
Three original multiplane cameras still exist today. One at the Walt Disney Animation Studios in Burbank, one at the Art of Disney Animation attraction in Disneyland Paris, and a third at the Walt Disney Family Museum in San Francisco.
To all who come to this happy place, welcome. Disneyland is your land. Here age relives fond memories of the past, and here youth may savor the challenge and promise of the future.
While Walt's accomplishments in film were groundbreaking, where his innovative mind especially shines is his work in the Disney parks. Since Disneyland's conception in the 1950s up until his death, together with the newly founded WED Enterprises, Walt constantly pushed the envelope to what guests could experience in theme parks. Inventions that are now staples of modern-day theme parks were constantly conceived and developed by Walt and his team beyond those green Disneyland gates. Most of Disney Park's major breakthroughs came from Walt's involvement in the World's Fair. One such breakthrough was Walt Disney's audio animatronics. These robot figures moved and talked just like living beings, and with these new toys, Walt's Imagineers could develop new ways to tell stories in a three-dimensional theme park environment. Although looking primitive compared to some of Disney's more modern audio animatronics, at the time, the Abraham Lincoln animatronic from the Great Moments with Mr. Lincoln attraction was the most innovative and advanced figure ever produced. Creating it was difficult, as, unlike characters from the Carousel of Progress or It's a Small World, the Lincoln figure had to look exactly like the guy on the face of the $5 bill. Imagineer Bob Gurr said,
"Anyway, Walt pointed to this thing and said, 'Bobby, I want twice as many moves and half as much weight, and you gotta get started now, because I'm basically a car guy, an airplane guy, and I would see mechanical parts in a little bit different manner. I didn't see Lincoln as an animated figure. I saw it as an airplane. And I thought, Lincoln can be an airplane. This way I can have a space frame that's going to be very, very efficient as far as its size. And we can take the information we already learned on the General Electric figures, and I can make this thing lighter and stiffer and better and taller and neater. As you can appreciate, Lincoln is a very tall, skinny guy."
In Disneyland, even the structure of the park is meticulously designed. For example, when constructing some of the park's larger structures, in order to save money, the Imagineers incorporated the film technique of forced perspective, which makes small objects look taller. This was incorporated in the buildings along Main Street, the Matterhorn Mountain in Disneyland, and even the Disney Castle itself. How the technique works is that the buildings start out at normal proportions, then get gradually smaller as they get to the second and third stories, giving the illusion that it is bigger than it actually is. However, Walt wasn't done with pushing the boundaries of theme park design. He felt the park needed a central icon for guests to be drawn to. That icon was Sleeping Beauty Castle. The concept was simple. As the guests enter Disneyland, they see the castle ahead and are naturally drawn to it. From this center icon, the other lands fan out. Walt drew inspiration for this design choice from an early Italian architectural style called the hub and spoke. It's like the wheel of a bicycle. The hub is the castle, and the spokes are the different lands that fan out from it, each distinguished by unique colours on the ground, in order to make the boundaries between them easily identifiable.
The most exciting, by far the most important part of our Florida project, in fact, the heart of everything we'll be doing in Disney World, will be our experimental prototype city of tomorrow. We call it Epcot.
But Walt didn't stop at just entertainment. He wanted to reinvent how we lived our lives, a living blueprint of the future. An idea was conceived for a planned community that would draw on the latest technology and innovation as a major component to his Florida project, or as it's known today, Walt Disney World. Walt named his utopian city the Experimental Prototype Community of Tomorrow, or Epcot. It would feature commercial, residential, industrial, and recreational centers, all interconnected by a mass transport system. Walt was inspired to create such a community due to his desire to replace the inefficient infrastructure from the urban sprawl of 1960s America, as well as being inspired by innovative movements such as modernism and futurism. Disney purchased 27,433 acres worth of land for Epcot and his Florida project. That's twice the size of Manhattan. And on November 15th, 1965, Walt Disney formally announced the new resort in a press conference with Florida Governor Hayden Burns.
The Disney organization carried out a tremendous amount of research before selecting Florida as the location for their new project. Here at this press conference held in Orlando, everyone anxiously anticipated the announcement of plans for the new Disney complex in Florida.
Well, Mr. Governor, this has been a wonderful reception that you've given us here. All the faces seem friendly, and we feel very much at home. And of course, this is a big, exciting project for us too, you know. I mean, in fact, it's the biggest thing we've ever tackled.
However, just a year after announcing his Florida project, Walter Elias Disney sadly passed away due to lung cancer. His brother, Roy E. Disney, continued on the new Florida resort, renaming it to Walt Disney World in his brother's honor.
Walt Disney World is a tribute to the philosophy and the life of Walter Elias Disney, and to the talents, the dedication, and the loyalty of the entire Disney organization that made Walt Disney's dream come true. May Walt Disney World bring joy and inspiration and new knowledge to all who come to this happy place. A magic kingdom where the young at heart of all ages can laugh and play and learn together. Dedicated this 25th day of October, 1971.
Walt's original idea for Epcot was eventually abandoned, citing the impracticality of maintaining and operating the city. But in 1982, the concept was reshaped into a second theme park in Walt Disney World, which would be modelled after a World's Fair, showcasing the latest modern innovations, as well as other cultures, through its two distinct lands, Future World and World Showcase. In summary, throughout his impressive career, Walt Disney constantly pushed boundaries and broke limits of what was possible in the film, sound, and theme park industry. From groundbreaking successes such as the world's first feature-length animated film, to attempting to reinvent society and how we live our lives. However, with all this success and accomplishment, do Walt's high standards of innovation still hold up in the modern-day Walt Disney Company? Or has the Magic Kingdom fallen from grace?
My name is Emily Henderson. I am a sketch artist here at the Disneyland Resort in California, and I love my job. I get to sit in air conditioning and draw Disney characters all day. Working for Disney, I've been a cast member overall for about nearly 10 years at this point. So in November, it'll be my 10-year anniversary. I'll get a new pin on my
birthday.
But otherwise I've been part of the sketch program here for about 4 years, and it's been really, really fun. I get to sell my art at Disneyland, and that's not something a lot of people can say.
Would you say that Disney's work has, you know, affected just like life in general for, like, you know, Disney fans or people in general?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I think, you know, Disney as a company and, you know, as a entertainment company and stuff, has been incredibly influential for so many facets of life, like, you know, just pop culture in general, but also, and this applies to me too, like inspiring young artists to want to pursue like things like animation and storyboarding and whatnot. And you know, it was seen as such like a kind of a childish thing for so long to do like animation and art, and now it's, you know, it's seen as a very serious art form nowadays, I think. And I think that's really, really cool, that push that Walt was able to, you know, bring into the public eye. And being such an innovator with things like, you know, animation in general. Like, Disney is one of the big pioneers of animation and of art and storytelling. Like, you know, Snow White was the first feature-length animated film. And that's a pretty cool thing to say. Like, yeah, I work for the company that, you know, taught the world how to do a lot of this stuff. So, yeah, I would say so.
What would your opinions be on Walt Disney as like a creator or an innovator, you know, himself?
He was definitely very, I say this in a very nice way, he was very stubborn, where he wanted his way or the highway a lot of the time. A big misconception that a lot of people don't realize when it comes to art specifically was that Walt really wasn't that much of an artist. When it came to designing like Mickey, he actually worked with a good friend of his, a coworker named Ub Iwerks, to create Mickey. Not a lot of people give Ub a lot of credit, which is very sad. Yeah, because Oswald was his first character that he created, but it wasn't created on his own terms. You know, it was a commission from somebody, from Universal. And so the fact that he was like, well, I want to make my own character so that I can do what I want with it, and nobody can tell me otherwise, is I think, a pretty genius idea. And I think it was also a very smart move on his part to realize, like, hey, I'm not much of an artist myself. I could be very stubborn about this and try to, you know, do all this work on my own, but I think that's a really poor decision, and instead I think it'd probably be wiser if I was able to divide and conquer and bring in other brilliant minds to help me create this vision and not just crash and burn on my own, you know? So yeah, he was quite a smart person when it came to a lot of his ideas. I was happy to help. I did a project back in high school on Walt Disney too, so.
It's clear to see how other creators have been inspired by Disney's work. Without Walt creating the world's first feature-length animated film with 1938's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs, founder of Pixar John Lasseter would never have created Toy Story, the first ever feature-length computer animated film. You see, Lasseter took on Disney's same ideals of ignoring doubters, even in the face of possible failure. While initially scrapped in the development of Walt Disney World, Walt's original concept for an experimental planned community was later revisited in 1996, with the self-governed, master-planned community suburb named Celebration, located in Osceola County, Florida. In 2001, the town was named New Community of the Year by Urban Land Institute, and, as of the latest US census in 2020, the town has a population of 11,077 residents. It is because of the strong values of innovation left by Walt that his vision of Epcot could be finally realized. Walt's work in founding the Disney Parks and Walt Disney Imagineering paved the way for the next generation of Imagineers to constantly push new boundaries in the parks. For example, audio animatronics have been pushed far beyond what was previously possible, with more and more realistic and complex figures being produced. Today, the most advanced animatronic ever created is the Navi Shaman animatronic, found in the Navi River Journey attraction in the Avatar-themed land in Walt Disney World's Animal Kingdom. Thanks to Walt Disney and his Imagineers' groundbreaking invention, audio animatronics have become a staple in most major theme parks around the world, such as Universal Studios, as well as in Hollywood blockbusters such as Jaws or Jurassic Park.
Take those turbo lifts and stay out of trouble!
Hey, you're not authorized! Wait, the doors are the prisoners!
We have a breach in attention lottery!
Explode! Find an alternate route! Who picked these two droids anyway?
Who are you?
Attention door breach! Prisoners not seen on level D!
Star Wars Galaxy's Edge's newest ride, Rise of the Resistance, is the most technologically advanced theme park attraction in existence today. It incorporates multiple ride systems, including trackless dark ride vehicles, motion simulators, a scaled-down version of Disney's Tower of Terror dropshaft, and many screens, projections, and theatrical illusions, which all come together to bring the characters of the Star Wars universe to life. So, to answer the question if Walt Disney's values of innovation are still alive in the modern day, I would say absolutely yes. Walt inspired the next generation of innovators, and I can confirm that Disney has not yet lost its touch for detail, innovation, and those final magic touches.
imagination, huh?